She was very kind to me. And as a newcomer, you know, I didn't know what was going on. And she taught us Pascal, and unfortunately, that's the only thing I remember that she went through in that class. And I was always amazed how intelligent, how smart she was. And you know, I was quite lost, whatever, you know, do this in the class. And needless to say that I didn't do very well. And then later on, things happened, and I went to politics. So I apologize if somehow I brought down the IQ average. But you know, I'll try. So I'm really honored to be here on behalf of Reza Moretti, the Minister for Trinity College University, celebrating Women in Computing. Congratulations to University of Guelph for hosting this fifth conference of the Ontario celebrating Women in Computing, and for putting your focus squarely on diversity. I particularly want to recognize all universities and industry participants and corporate partners who are here this evening, that you're or understand the benefit of a more diverse workforce here in one of the most diverse provinces. And we've done our part. We've elected the first female premier in Ontario history. So speaking of diversity in the industry, I also want to extend a special welcome to the students attending from all across the province. We're very glad that you've chosen to pursue a career in computer science. I understand that about 10% of the students in computer science programs mentioned earlier are women, and that ratio continues to be reflected throughout the profession. We know that our society and our economy will continue to lose out if this trend continues. More diversity in our post-secondary classrooms, our workplaces, and our computer labs can lead to better ideas and more innovation, and that will help to produce industry leaders that we need to maintain competitive in the future. By supporting and encouraging the recruitment of young women into the computer science field, Ontario celebrates Women in Computing brings the post-secondary education sector and the industry and the business partner that I mentioned earlier together to build a stronger, diverse computer science community within Ontario. As the parliamentary assistant to Ontario's Minister of Training College University, I'm a part of the team that charged with making sure that our students can get the education and training they need to pursue their dreams and succeed. Our government is committed to providing students with access to a strong, high-quality post-secondary education. For example, we provide support to first-generation students. I wish, you know, that happened to me, who are the first in their family to pursue post-secondary education. We've also increased the number of spaces for graduate students, but we can't do that alone. It's groups like this and university and industry leaders that work together that we can achieve these common goals. On behalf of the Ontario government, I congratulate Ontario celebration of Women in Computing, and I particularly wish the students here tonight all the best in the future and have a very successful conference. But now it's my great pleasure to introduce someone I had the pleasure to work with years back, the Minister of Education, the Honorable Liz Sandals. Minister Sandals has represented the riding of Guelph at the Ontario Legislature since 2003. She served as a parliamentary assistant to the Minister of Health, Long-Term Care, Transportation, Education, Government Services, Community Safety, and Correctional Services. That is half of the cabinet. I never realized that. As a Minister of Education, Liz Sandals has overseen the development of a new collective bargaining framework, has taken steps to modernize child care in the province, and release Achieving Excellence, a renewed version for education in Ontario. And that's very important to me personally, because I have two little ones in the public system. And I look forward to support that bill once it gets presented in the legislature. She has led the government's Safe School Action Team. Minister Sandals first became involved in politics with education issues She was elected to the local public school board in 1988 and was re-elected four times. She served as a chair of the board and was elected as president of the Ontario Public School Board Association from 1998 to 2002. She also sat on the board of directors of the Canadian School Boards Association. Mr. Sandals worked as a computer programmer and analyst and taught computer science at the University of Guelph prior to being elected. I wish you were my high school teacher. And she grew up in Guelph and received her Bachelor of Science from the University of Guelph, as well as Master of Mathematics from the University of Waterloo. I heard someone was cheering from the University of Waterloo. And so please help me welcome the Honorable Liz Sandals, Minister of Education.
Thank you, Han, and good evening, everyone. It's great to be here. For all of you who came up or down 401, whichever direction, welcome to Guelph. It's great to see so many of you gathering here from all over the province, and thank you to the organizers from Guelph for inviting me. Deb, who was up here earlier, Deb and I have had assorted relationships. I first discovered Deb when she was a student. I used to hire all the markers and the TAs, so then she was an employee. Then she was a colleague. She has been known to put her lawn sign out for me. Anyway, we go through a whole bunch of different relationships as life has unfolded. Thank you, Deb, for all the fine work you've done and all your colleagues. Inspiring women come into computing. I really like the name, not the aunt, which is sort of quackier or even something. But what I really like is the O and the C, which is celebration. That we're here to celebrate the fact that all of you are joining into the profession of computer science, into computer studies. So I do think this is a great name that you've got here. When we ask the question, why does it matter that we have women in computer science? And computer science is an interesting conundrum because we just start with a general shortage of people in computer science, and then you get to the shortage of women. And by the time you get to women, there's this huge shortage, because you could probably argue that while there may be 12-15% of the computer science students are women, 100% of computer science students is actually too small a number. We could do with more of everybody, but in particular, part of the way we shift that is to get more women. Why does this matter? If you think of what Ontario's economic strengths have traditionally been, it's been in the area of manufacturing and the area of agriculture and food processing. And agriculture and food processing even today is actually the second biggest industry in Ontario. If you think about the survival of those two industries, the only part of manufacturing that's going to survive is going to be advanced manufacturing. The part of food processing and agriculture, well, we will continue to eat food, but the parts that are going to thrive here in Ontario, what have been production, are going to be very high-tech processing and all sorts of biotech. So out of those traditional industries, which you might have thought of as being possibly lower skilled originally, the part that will survive here in Ontario is going to be the high-skilled part, and the high-skilled part uses people who know computer science. And then if you look into the emerging economy, where we will go in the future to find strength, it's all going to be the knowledge-based economies. And it doesn't matter whether it's the creative side of that, so the design and all the digital and entertainment and gaming stuff, computer science, or whether we're thinking about maybe mining. If you go into the mine, the last time I was down in a mine, which I don't do frequently, But the last time I was down in a mine, the person who was showing us around was a young woman, and she happened to be an engineer. But the point being that even a resource industry today to survive, you need the high-tech extraction, computer science. You can look at just about everything we're going to do, the financial industry. Just about anything we're going to do in the future is going to be knowledge-based, high-tech. We need you. We need computer science. So it really, really matters that we don't have enough people, and in particular, it really, really matters that we don't have enough women. If we're going to have a healthy economy in the future, we need to figure out what to do about the shortage, and frankly, not just of computer science, although this is particularly critical, but the whole STEM area, science, technology, engineering, math, computer science. The whole area is short of people. So what are some of our challenges? Well, and I'm elementary and secondary education, so let's look at that. If you look at the stats, far too many people drop math before they get to grade 12. And if you drop math before you get to grade 12, you just slam the door in the face of a whole lot of career options. I'm often amazed when students, you know, when I'm talking to them and I'll say, you know, what do you want to do? And they'll tell me something and I'll say, oh, well, I hope you're keeping up your math. And they look at me with horror. Math? Well, you're going to need math to do that. And it's getting actually more and more critical that you have some math. Because lots of things that you maybe didn't traditionally think you needed math for, or computer science, need it now. So if you're going to be a social scientist, odds are now that you actually aren't just going to be doing qualitative description, you're going to be doing quantitative descriptions. And if you're going to be doing quantitative analysis, you really better know some math and computer science. Because you're actually going to need that to do social science. So, and there's all kinds of things like that, that people don't get it, that if you dropped math, you actually slammed the door. Valerie Davidson, who's a professor emeritus from the engineering side, and Women in Engineering, because we have another organization that's sort of your sister organization, which is Women in Engineering. Valerie did a great analysis of women hanging in there. If you look at physics, it's what? Like by the time you get to grade 12, what's the number?
About 33%.
But how many of the total females are actually left by the time they get to grade 12 physics? Like it's about less than, about 10% of high school graduates have actually survived. Or 8%, something like that. Valerie will come up with the right number by the end of the speech. But there's the point being that a huge number of people drop math, even more people drop physics. So again, a massive slam of the door in terms of a whole bunch of careers. Then as STAO, which is the Science Teachers Association of Ontario, actually did a study with their members, and one of the things they talked to, and these are science teachers, what are you comfortable teaching? And everybody was quite comfortable with biology. Most teachers were pretty comfortable with chemistry. Math, not so much. Physics, forget it. And computing, no clue. And that goes back to the problem that Wendy was describing, which is computer science is an optional course. There are computer studies. I asked my bureaucrats the other day, how many schools actually offer the optional computer studies courses? And there's 600 schools in Ontario that offer at least one of the computer studies courses. But that means there's less than a third of the high schools are actually offering that optional course. And of those 600, they don't necessarily all offer the, you know, they may have the grade 10 introductory course, but they don't necessarily carry through into the 11 and 12 university stream courses or the 11 and 12 college stream courses. So you've got this sort of vicious circle, which is part of that's because there's a shortage of people who actually get a B.Ed. with a computer science designation, so that there aren't very many people out there qualified. The people who are there who aren't qualified to do computer science don't really feel comfortable with it, because if you think about those stats, they're really biological sciences, and we don't have a problem with women in biological sciences. We have lots of those. But if you look at just who is teaching high school science, it tends towards the biological sciences rather than the physical sciences. So there's just this shortage of people who can even teach computer science in high school, and therefore, so you get this vicious circle. It isn't getting taught. Because it isn't getting taught, nobody actually requires it as a university entrance, because it isn't, like, even to get into computer studies, the computer science at university, nobody requires computer studies to get into computer science, because your numbers would drop even lower. So you've actually got this vicious circle. Is it sort of out there, and how do you get into it? So that describes the problem for you. But if you think about the problem that way, and you're asking yourself, how do you get more women into computer science, we tend to think of that as a university problem. The truth of the matter is, it's actually an elementary and secondary school problem, that we actually need to get girls' interest in science and technology and engineering and math and computing long before you get to the door of the university, because by the time you get to the door of the university, most people have actually already shut it out as a career path. If we want people to be involved, we need to actually go back sooner. So, or earlier. So some of you may know that Google has committed to investing $50 million to close the tech gender gap, which is amazing news. But I thought some of the things that they captured in the announcement that they put out are really very interesting. So, consistent with all the stats you've heard tonight, Google said that only 17% of its tech employees are women. There will be $1.4 million, this is US stats obviously, $1.4 million computing jobs available in 2020, but only 400,000 computer science grads from universities to fill them. So, and then they go on to describe all the stats that you've already heard. What I found really interesting though was some research that they had done trying to figure out the why. So they said Google found that most girls decide before they even enter college, and by that they mean university because this is US talk, whether they want to learn to code. So the tech world must win them over at a younger age. They also found that there were four major factors that determined whether girls opted into computer science. Social encouragement, self-perception, academic exposure, which is the lack of the high school computer science course, and career perception, which is the male geek thing. Okay? So, and what they also found was that increased exposure will build up girls' confidence in their coding abilities. And in a word association part of the study, the girls who were unfamiliar with computer science identified it most with the words boring, technology, hard, difficult. While those who had had some exposure to computer science used the words technology, programming, future, fun. So if you didn't sort of have some exposure, you couldn't possibly have a positive attitude. First of all, you had to have some exposure to have a positive attitude. The other thing they found was that social encouragement matters more to girls than to boys, and that any exposure to coding was better than none at all. So kids who can't take a computer science class in high school would gain something from attending an after-school program, a camp, or even playing a computer game at home. And then I thought this was an interesting statement. You can't be what you can't see. It goes back to the whole exposure thing. Who are the role models? And if you can't see the careers that are computer science related, why would you want to be part of computer science? So it went on to talk about the fact that we actually need to help young women see the possibilities. And the possibilities aren't all just sitting in the office coding in sort of the classic geek perception. And I can say that because I'm one of you. But they needed to see this in the connection between computer science and various related job opportunities. So it might be, how does computer science, how's it used in international development work? Or how's it used in graphic arts? Or how might it be related to choreography for dancing? Or how do you use it in music? Or medicine, or you can go on, or. But people actually needed to be able to see the connection between the things that you really do with computing science and studying the subject. And that just isn't happening now. It occurred to me that as I was thinking about this and, you know, some of the issues, is I actually probably got into computer science because I started out in math because there was a math program. And we didn't have a computer science department at the University of Guelph when I started. And I got into computer science somewhere along the way because I actually liked people and solving problems. And computer science is sort of, well, I want to talk to real people and solve real problems. And that takes you either into Valerie's engineering or Deb's computer science world. And that people need to see the connection that this is actually an opportunity to solve real problems. The social encouragement piece is really interesting because if you step back and you think about the girls that we need to influence, it's back there about grade 7, 8, 9, 10, that you really need to hook people on sticking with the science and math. Well, I can remember when I was in grade 9, I decided I should be a cheerleader. Do you want to know why? Because I was actually smart and I would get prizes for being the top girl or the top kid. And being a cheerleader was sort of a, hey, I'm socially acceptable too. I remember a classmate of my son's who was brilliant, and she always showed up at the high school, you know, graduation commencement ceremony awards program. And she, I can think over the years of sitting on a platform, because I was a trustee, so I'd be there handing out awards. One year she was orange, one year she was green, one year she was purple, one year she was blue. Now, this is total. She would have purple hair, a purple dress that was this long, this low, and you can't believe how tight. Somebody can do a sausage thing. And slight heel J high. Do you know why? I like the other sort of adults would be sitting there. But I got it. She was going to walk across the stage four times for getting the subject prize for being the smartest person in that subject. And she wanted everybody in the audience to remember what she was wearing, so somebody would ask her to dance at the dance that weekend, rather than remembering that she was the smart girl. She was looking for social encouragement, for social acceptance. So when we start to think about how do we recruit girls, we need to actually think about the fact that we're trying to do this at the stage that girls are actually the most vulnerable to social pressure to behaving like a girl. And they're also probably at sort of the lowest point in being self-confident. I mean, that's just the way hormones and development and all that stuff is happening. So we've got this problem that something that's really socially unacceptable is the thing that we have to overcome. And I don't think we usually build that into the equation. The equation is how do you get people to do science? But it's actually with girls a bigger issue. So we need to figure this out. How do you make computer science and math and physics and all the, because it isn't girls can't do it. You know you can do it. It's how do you make them want to keep doing it so that they don't close the doors through that period of, I want to be socially acceptable, I don't want to be smart. Okay, so not to be a total downer, there's actually some things that are going on in education in Ontario that you could probably help with. So, Han mentioned that we just have new vision for education in Ontario. There's a number of things that are in there. We did consultations all over the province. And one of the things that we heard from the students is that students really, really, really want to have an opportunity to have experiential learning. And what you often hear from academic students is there aren't really the opportunities to do co-ops and experiential learning because you're, you know, in that crowded course schedule, where on earth do you have the time for that? So that's something we have to figure out. But students really said, we want to be able to experience the real world. We want to be able to explore connections to the real world. We want to explore what real careers are out there. And we want to be able to get that information. And so there's an opportunity for people who are out there in the real world doing real computer science things to actually connect into young people and actually demonstrate what they're doing. So we need to think about how do we make that real. The other thing is that the science teachers group, is actually quite actively interested in how we promote stuff and some of the same issues. So there's actually an opportunity for some connections here in promoting because people are actually open to how do you make the connections. But a couple of other specific things that are some opportunities. You're going to hear from Bonnie tomorrow about Let's Talk Science, so other than just to say, come and listen to Bonnie. But the idea here is to connect with kids with hands-on science-y things that they can do, be it at the elementary or at secondary stage, and that real students like you can be the salespeople, and Bonnie will talk to you about that tomorrow. The other thing where there's an opportunity, and this may be at this point targeted more at the adults in the audience, but one of the things that we've introduced into Ontario high schools is something called a specialist high skills major. And the specialist high skills major allow people to take a cluster of courses, some of which will be experiential or co-op, But it's arranging the course load so that you've got a cluster of courses that lead to actually a red seal on the diploma that says you've done a specialist high skills major in X. The original conception of these was mainly focused on things like construction and manufacturing and some of the more skills-based area. But the way the program is structured, they can be targeted towards people going to college or people going to university. And some of them actually are targeted to university. There is a, now let me see if I can find the numbers here. One of the specialist high skills majors is information and communication technology. There's 120 high schools that have the program now with 2,837 students registered at last count. There's a business high skills major, and it could obviously tie into computing. There's 132 schools to offer that with 3,852 students. Why do I mention this? Each one of these programs, most things we just say, here's the curriculum and turn it over to the school board to do. The ministry actually approves each and every one of these specialist high skills majors. And we, one of the things that's required is that you need employer partners. And this is why I said this is really to the adult, the employer age people in the audience, is that there are opportunities to have a specialist high skills major where you or a cluster of businesses in your community are providing the experiential learning part. And these programs can be tailored so that they focus more on the university entrance screen. They don't have to be targeted towards more the trades and apprentice stream. They can be focused on college or university streams depending on how the local design works. They're quite flexible. They're deliberately designed so that you can tailor them to the local employment market. So there's actually a possibility there for people to set up partnerships with their local school boards and their local schools to work to have some of these programs in place that actually will attract students at the high school level into doing some of the studies that we want them to do. Anyway, we have more work to do on this, but this is something that is really, really important, so we need to keep doing the work on it. And at this point, the Ministry of Education and in the government understand that what you are doing is important to the future of the province. So we want to work with you and make it happen. Thank you.